Are we ready with the live case? Great. Mark, can you hear us?
Yes, sure can.
We hear you very well. Go ahead.
Great. So we have a couple of interesting cases here. Paul's in the next room getting ready with one that I think you'll enjoy. And what we have here is a case of a patient who presented with retinal artery occlusion and was found to have high velocities in the left carotid artery. We have an MR, which can we show the MR to the audience?
MR in your.
So you can see here with the MR, very nice images, a little bit of plaque in the aortic arch, probably a type 2 on the low end of a type 2. Vertebrals are good, contralateral circulation is good, and you can see that there's a high-grade stenosis in the left internal. So we thought that this would be a very good case, first of all, to treat percutaneously, and then secondly, we also thought that this would be a good case for the MoMA device. Any comments from the panel?
Any comments right off the bat from our panel on this case and its approach to embolic protection?
Can we see the angio of this stenosis? Can we see any angio? Yeah. It's only
just the MR so far.
MRI, yeah. Yeah, it's definitely better for
it. Right now we are... So we do
option,
have an angio.
The option is to use the proximal protection or is available on the cath lab proximal protection. Or
yes, the MoMA device is what they've thought about.
Yes, so there's a good option, and I think that is good case for the proximal protection.
Great. Any other comments about protection, proximal versus distal, from our panel? No, I think, Mark, we've got general agreement on the approach. I will reflect as you get access here that I asked for proximal protection a few years back when I was doing a live case at Asan, and they told me that they didn't have it. And because it was a case even more complex than this in terms of its tortuosity, and I said, well, this would be a good case for Dr. Layard to do. And they told me that Dr. Layard thought it would be a good case for me. So... ended up doing
that's
it with filters.
That's fair enough.
Yeah, it ended up doing it with filters, and it's very difficult with a filter to do some of these tortuous cases because of the difficulty not only in placing the filters but also in retrieving the filter through a what's going to be a fairly tortuous stent segment. So it can be challenging and potentially complicated for the patient. So, Mark, why don't you walk us through where you are now?
We have an angio. I wonder if we could demonstrate the. The angio on the upper. Well, okay, so first of all, before we did the MoMA, we wanted to make sure that we had an adequate diameter common femoral, and I think we're clearly in the adequate range there. I'm assuming that you're seeing that in the auditorium?
Yes.
Okay, and then we took an injection of the carotid to confirm that it was indeed high grade, and you can see that angio here. Then we could go to the intracerebral subtracted AP cranial, and you can see that the middle cerebral fills, and there's phasic flow in the anterior cerebral. So, and comparable images in the lateral. So what we are doing right now is positioning an amplat superstiff into the external carotid. Was hoping to have a little better purchase on the external carotid before we put the amplat superstiff. So we're just kind of barely into the external carotid, bringing an amplat superstiff in. You probably have the live image there, correct?
Yes, we do. I have a good image, actually.
I think the superior sidereal artery positions looks very low. So any comments for...
Yeah, the superior thyroidal does have a low origin.
Yeah, my sense about the superior thyroidal is the following. I think that while it clearly can be a communication for a retrograde flow into the carotid artery, and this is my personal opinion, my sense is that if you've occluded everything else in the external carotid artery, that unless you have a chronic external carotid artery stenosis, which would promote the development of collateralization, which typically would be superior thyroidal to superior thyroidal, that you don't usually get retrograde flow in that from that vessel. That's my sense of it. And I don't mean to be cavalier or glib about occluding that. I try to occlude it when I can, but I don't lose a lot of sleep over it if I can't, so long as the external carotid artery is patent, reasonably patent. I don't know if other people have opinions about that or not, but that's, and in a, we did a retrospective analysis of the MoMA trial, actually, and the Gore trials, looking at the angiography, and the majority of cases, these superior thyroidals were not covered, and people did very well anyway.
It's just confirming where we are. I think what we'll do is we'll use the glide wire to get a little bit better purchase here, and then we'll go with the AmpLat super stiff.
Are you having trouble making that turn, Mark, the kind of retroflex left carotid?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I saw the MR. It looks like it might be a problem.
And what size of MoMA device? You want to use 9 or 8 French?
We have a 9 pole.
9.
So let's talk about other approaches to access. Anybody on the panel like different approaches to access than we're seeing here? No? Everybody likes this approach, Mark?
Okay.
The access is a crucial point in carotid stenting, particularly with this sharp takeoff of left common carotid artery. So my lecture will be a little, some solution is a radial approach in some cases, so you see. However, is a really, really important thing to access to common carotid artery.
It's
so
critical.
It's a crucial point
yeah.
in carotid stenting.
And we know that because in about 20% of the procedures that are performed, the strokes that occur are contralateral to the actual index lesion, presumably all from access manipulation. So access is key not only to the performance of the procedure, but also to the safety for the patient and the stroke outcomes.
Let's just go up a little bit higher and see that.
Looks like you have a pretty good purchase there. Are you using the 7-centimeter tip, 6-centimeter tip?
I'm using the one they handed me. I'm not exactly sure. So, it's an AmpLat super stiff with an angled tip.
Yep. That's great.
And so we'll get the, we used a VTK, which initially caused a little bit of problems because it engaged the common carotid very nicely, but then when we first started to advance the glide wire, it actually bucked it out. So we had to get a little better purchase. Once we had a little better purchase with the VTK, we were all right.
And you work in a coronary lab?
We are in lab one. This is a coronary lab.
Right. So for those of you who don't work routinely in coronary labs, this I could tell that because he wasn't expanding his field of view to look at the aorta as well as his distal wire tip. So that can be a little bit challenging on some of these exchanges because you don't have a full extent of the field of view. I've been impressed, Mark, that the both the Gore device, which is no longer available, but also the MoMA device, have a although they're large, nine French devices, actually track extremely well for their size and don't give us as much trouble as we thought they might for access. Has that been your sense as well?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right, and I think the AmpLat super stiff has a lot to do with that. So you've got a nice supportive wire, and I think, you know, it seems that one of the biggest limitations sometimes is what you have at the groin. If you have a real vasculopathic patient, you may have trouble with being able to access with a 9 French sheath, and then you have to completely change your strategy after you've gotten your access.
Do you routinely pre-close these, or do you put a larger 10 French sheath in so you can monitor systemic pressure?
We routinely do not oversize the sheath, and we typically will do an 8 French angiosteal.
So So it looks like you're having a sheath.
I'll have you study
groin-related issue there.
Study that wire for me.
I will say that one of
the discussions.
I was going to say that I do use the 10-French sheath with a second pressure manometer, and there's two advantages to that. One is I get systemic pressure continuously through the procedure, but also I don't struggle like you're struggling a little bit now through the skin and access point, and lose my tactile feedback on some of that on some of the transmission. It does make a bigger hole.
I think that's a very good point.
Yeah, it does make a bigger hole, but it's only one French more. So for those of you not familiar with the MoMA, he's placing the tip of that marker there is at the site of
the angiogram. I want to see exactly where the origin of the vessel is.
There you go.
There's kind of a, almost like a triangle.
You should have pointed out that the lesion is very high, so it's not case for the endarterectomy, so this only option endovascular treatment. So maybe it's some vascular surgeon to comment this lesion and this strategy.
Well, I'm a vascular surgeon, I would say. And my choice would be open surgery. It's pretty good location and below its joint angle, so it's be easy to fix. So it means either both methods are possible for the patient, so you can do either open or endovascular. So. And taking account high stenotic lesion, so I don't know, from my point, open surgery would be even more safe, but of course it's durable in endovascular way as well.
So you think it's more durable?
Well, yeah.
No. Based on what data? No, there's no data that says that stenting is less durable than surgery. In fact, the CREST trial that looked at 1,200 patients in each arm showed absolutely no difference between both revascularization rates and stroke rates. They were all very durable and excellently low in both arms. So I would take issue with that. I would take issue with the safety piece too, but that's for another day. Because we really don't have randomized data against surgery and proximal protection.
There also. Yeah.
But it was spoken like a true surgeon. I admire you. So, Mark, you're in the position you like so far?
Yeah, I think we'll do a little puff here just to make sure that we really like it.
And I noticed you left your wire in just until you're certain, right?
Right. So mandrel's out, the wire's in. So I think we could go a little bit more distally. You agree with that, Bill?
Yeah, it's pretty darn close, though, yeah.
And this is our 50-50, yes, correct?
It's also important thing in this case will be stent selection, because there is sharp angle of internal carotid, and there is important to have many devices for such a case. That's too low.
Obviously too low there.
Yeah, definitely too low.
Almost by the size of the balloon, you could tell that, yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right.
If you pull back a little bit wire, it will be easier to go. Not much better right now.
So for the audience not familiar with this, he's looking for the balloon to, it's an elastomeric balloon, which actually is very soft and compliant. He's looking for that balloon to square off or get some non-rounded straight edges, which will tell him that he's in that position with the wall. So now you can see that kind of almost trapezoidal look out of the balloon. He's pulling back to see if he can occlude that more proximal superior thyroidal.
And the most important thing with proximal
protection. I think you can spend a lot of time trying to get that to occlude, and I think your point is a good one, Bill, that up to a point it's worth the effort, but I'm not sure that we're going to go to extreme measures to get that.
I mean, sometimes it actually
extends the case.
Sometimes it actually snugs right into the vessel itself, but most of the time it doesn't. So
are you happy with that, or would you?
I think it looks pretty good. I don't know. Do people want to chase that superior thyroidal, or are we all okay with that on panel? I think I'm getting a lot of positive feedback here, Mark.
Okay.
Now, I know some operators that will leave that wire in the valve only to prevent the 14,000th wire from exiting and going into that little valve for whatever reason seems to do more frequently than it should.
Uh-huh.
I play it both ways. But.
Actually, it looks like we still have some.
Yeah, that valve's one way. So
flow through the valve.
Yeah. No, it won't flow the other way, though, so that's okay.
All right, so I think we're good to go here with proximal occlusion. We have. Let's make sure that we have everything set up. Do we have our 14,000th wire? We need a 14,000th wire to cross. Any non-hydrophilic 14 wire?
14,000 wire, obviously.
And Mark, what stent, and that was brought up earlier, what stent would you think to use here?
So we're going to use a set. No, we need a 14 wire for the balloons. Yeah, like a Spartacore, BMW, anything like that. So our plan is to use a 7-10-40 AccuLink. We talked about the various, so we have available here a Precise, we have the Invatec balloon, we have the wall stent, and we opted for the 7-10-40 AccuLink. Thoughts on that?
Anybody have thoughts on stent choice?
No. In my practice, I will use hybrid stents. It's a typical case for Cristallo stents, open and closed, and the mid part of the stent is definitely better for such a case. It's a closed stent for the lesion and open for the better opacification. It is very good in such a tortuosity of this internal coronary artery. I will never use the wall stent in such a case like this.
So one of the problems with the Cristallo, I understand your point there, but this lesion is actually fairly long. If you look at the lesion, it begins at the proximal aspect of that internal carotid artery and extends all the way back down to this common carotid artery, probably a centimeter beyond that.
But the 40 millimeter length of Cristallo.
No, I know, but my point is the closed cell segment of the Cristallo is only 2 centimeters. I don't think it covers that lesion.
Ready and the stent
but I mean
ready.
The best option for such a case.
But I think any open cell stent would be
okay. I don't like
here, right?
Open cells design stents and so.
But my point is you're going to be using the open cell portion of the Cristallo at some point. That's my only point. Yeah. So I think it's probably dealer's choice. You know, the newer stents that are available today in Europe, there is now in the Seaguard stent, the Terumo Road Saver stent. These two stents are quite interesting, right?
Yeah, yes.
What do you think?
Yeah. Currently we are... We are using the Seaguard, which is the most open cell design stent, which is covered by a small mesh. So I look at this case, and I'm a student here because I've never used MoMA before.
But the stent choice, I think, is appropriate. Yeah. If we had a mesh covered stent, I would like that for this case because it's open cell. The Road Saver is not open cell, but the Seaguard is. And the Gore scaffold stent is also open cell mesh covered. And I like those mesh covered stents for a lot of the things we worry about with stents, in terms of plaque protrusion and so on. It takes away the issue of open cell, closed cell entirely. And it's a good option that I hope that we'll have available shortly in the U.S. and in Europe already.
Yeah, one big advantage is that with this stent you don't have, or almost don't have foreshortening. And the adaptation to the diameter is very good because it can go from distal internal to the common and adapt nicely to the diameter of the vessel.
And do we
and is that flushed?
Just want to ask the panel, who likes to do primary stenting without predilation? And who likes to do predilation but no post-dilation?
I need the stored image with the external balloon.
I do the predilation with no post-dilation. What's your logic for doing no predilation, only post-dilation?
Definitely, I use a direct stenting.
Why?
75% of my cases I perform in direct stenting. If you have MoMA device, you must collect the time. You must to short the procedure because you have blockage totally the flow. So the time of procedure is an incidence of intolerance is very important. So the predilatation prolonged the procedure. So the direct stenting surgery is very important. And also, I mean, if lesion not so many calcified, we have 5 French stent, we can do anywhere direct stenting.
So let me challenge that. If I do a predilation with a 4 millimeter balloon, and I put the stent in, and I don't need to do a post dilatation, I have the same time as you have. So that's the first challenge. The second challenge is that almost every study that's looked at the incidence of complications, the complications occur in the post dilation phase, not in the predilation phase. So my sense, and the second, third is that you have issues around crossing the lesion with a large stent, potentially, visualization, potentially. And so for those reasons, we use a lot of predilation and not so much post-dilation, maybe 50-75% no post-dilation. So I think you can make arguments on both
Bill,
sides.
I hate to interrupt.
Sorry, go ahead.
I hate to interrupt, but we're at the point now where we've done the proximal inflation with the balloon, and we have documented stasis of flow. Hopefully you have the screen image up there with the stasis and the common carotid.
We do, Mark. And are you using your external carotid balloon as a marker of your lesion, more or less?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think if we deploy the stent, the distal end of the stent, very close to the external balloon, I think we're going to be in pretty good position. What do you think, Bill?
I think you're probably right. You have to take into account it's been straightened a bit by the wire and so on. But yeah, it looks pretty good. So you used what balloon did you use to predilate?
Pre-dil. So we're putting a 4020 in right now. I actually prefer a little bit longer balloon because this is a pretty big diameter, and I'm a little concerned that we're going to have some watermelon seeding.
Sure.
But a 4020, typically I kind of undersize on the initial pre-dil, as I'm sure you do.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're going to do is go up right there.
Patient's tolerating it well so far?
Inflate the balloon.
Inflate?
So far, yeah.
Inflation.
Let's inflate. I want to see if we get kind of a dog bone appearance in the balloon.
Nominal pressure.
6, 18. Can I ask the position of the distal balloon? Because there is a branch, probably inferior thyroid artery from the external artery. I have a concern about the backflow from the artery during the. Is it okay? Yeah, looks okay, but does
it
matter?
We think it may be okay. But it's difficult to place that balloon sometimes over the superior thyroidal, so he's chosen this position.
Okay, we'll go with the stent now.
So 7-10-40. You can see him working quickly. Strategies for managing symptoms during proximal protection.
So you want to, first of all, aspirate. And after you've ascertained that the material that you're withdrawing has no emboli in it, then deflate the proximal balloon. See how the patient does, see if you can get them symptom-free, and if so, then kind of start back where you left off.
And sometimes...
Is that your approach?
Yeah, that's my approach. If the patient's having mild symptoms, I'll actually just raise the blood pressure systemically, which will increase cerebral perfusion collaterals, and usually will take care of the patient long enough to get the procedure done. And as you know, Mark, these procedures are no more than 5 or 6 minutes when done quickly and correctly. So this patient seems to be doing very well, which is great.
Yeah.
But cerebral perfusion
the
with
MR really seemed to.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say the MR seemed to demonstrate that he really had nice intracerebral reserve.
Right. And we saw that.
And I think, if anything, we'll take that a little bit higher rather than lower.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't see much of a downside in doing that.
The mobile system, I always try to use the EEG monitoring, interoperative EEG monitoring and interoperative TCD monitoring. It is very helpful to check the patient cerebral perfusion status. So I recommend you check the EEG. That is very helpful.
So you like EEG?
Yeah, interoperative EEG and TCD monitoring.
Okay, we'll take the 5-millimeter balloon now.
Gary, back to your question before. How many percentage of patients that you need to post-dilate after pre-dilatation?
I mean, we'd probably do less than 50% post-dilation. In the symptomatic patient with a soft plaque, we hardly ever dilate post-dilate. In the asymptomatic patient, we may do a little bit more because there tend to be more stable plaques. But, yeah.
You frequently do the pre-dilatation. Is that related to that you use a lot of open cell stents?
Come on down.
Oversized stent, yeah.
You see the bradycardia. You see the bradycardia.
Yeah. It looks like good placement by the outline of the stent, Mark.
Yeah. Actually, I wouldn't have minded having it a little bit more distally. And when I first put it in, I was kind of trying to get it to go more distal. And I thought I might have had it too distal, but if anything, I could have gone even farther out, but I think we got the lesion covered, which is the important thing. Now we need the aspiration syringe.
The fluoroscopy is difficult to identify the stent with. It's not that radiopaque, so it's hard sometimes.
So with the balloons occluded, and the patient's tolerating this quite well, we'll go ahead and aspirate. Do you even look at the first two syringes when you do it, Bill?
No, I don't. Mostly because there are not enough of those strainer cups to look.
Right. We need a waste container.
So what he's doing now is clearing the column. The balloons are still up. He's clearing the column from behind the balloons and in the static flow of the vessel around and in the stent. And in the third aspiration syringe, he will strain the contents to see if there's any residual material. If there is, he will continue to strain until he sees no more residual material coming out.
Do you have any debris in your syringe? Did you find something?
He's going to check.
I have
check
not
on
seen. We've
minute.
Just been putting it into a waste container right now. So far, it's just looked clear. This is now the third syringe that we're drawing off, and we will filter this one and see if that looks clear. Sometimes it's a little difficult, I've found, because it seems like it froths up just a little bit.
Where are you monitoring pressure, Mark?
At this point, we're pulling it off of the side sheath, and we're actually able to get a halfway decent pressure off the side sheath. And we look like we're clear here. Yeah, we're all clear.
Great. In some of these symptomatic patients, they can have quite a few syringefuls of material.
So we're deflating the ECA balloon. You'll see the CCA balloon deflating there. You can see there's a significant amount of recoil. The lesion is not really particularly calcified, but I think of all the stents we use, this is not a particularly robust stent. I think the amount of recoil that we're seeing is not surprising, but I also don't think that that'll be clinically important.
I mean, these stents tend to expand over time, actually, so I agree with you.
have it covered, but I would say that there's certainly no excess distally. We have not propagated the kink distally, so I think we're good there. And the common looks good, so I think we're in good shape.
Yeah, it looks like a very good coverage.
So what we'll do is we'll do a couple follow-up cerebral images under subtraction, and then we'll simply take this out, and I think it's time that they wanted to get started in the next room.
Mark, that was terrific. Thanks to you and the team there for a terrific case and expertly done. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the commentary. So let's do subtraction AP cranial.
Paul?
Yeah,
Paul, can you hear me? Good morning.
Yeah, we can hear you clear. Good morning, everyone. This morning, we are doing cases together with Dr. Lee. So I'll let my best friend to introduce the case first.
Thank you. This patient is a 60-year-old man. He has a history of, he has a multiple risk factors for the atherosclerosis. He has a long-standing DM more than 30 years, and he is a previously very heavy smoker, more than 2 packs a day. He recently stopped smoking, and he has also a history of dyslipidemia. For the several months, his visual acuity of left eye is gradually decreased. Therefore, he visited an eye clinic, and they found ocular ischemic syndrome. It's suspected that they found a post-carotid stenosis. Next page. Now, could you show the MR angiogram on the screen? Doppler ultrasound revealed a very tight stenosis of both proximal ICA and the very high velocity of the left proximal ICA. This is a MR angiogram. Could you explain the MR angiogram, Dr. Kao?
Yeah, well, the MR is pretty interesting. Very obviously, the right internal is narrowed, but also the left side is almost suboclusive. You can see the distal left ICA is almost flow collapsed. He has a very prominent left vertebra, but there is no significant right vertebra. And also, he had a tight stenosis on the origin of the right subclavian artery. And intracranially.
Intracranial, 보여주세요. 그거 말고 그 전에 거. 그 전에 거. 그 전 거요. 왼쪽, okay.
Yeah, intracranially, I think the bifurcation of the left distal ICA is somewhat diseased. Although the MCA and ACA on the left side looks healthy, but the T portion of the terminal carotid seems to be narrowed. But that also can be a flow-derived phenomenon. But anyway, we have a patient with a symptomatic left ICA suboclusive disease with a PSV greater than 5 meters per second, and also a concomitant right ICA stenosis, a hypoplastic or non-existing right vertebra with a tight right subclavian artery stenosis. So it's a very complicated case.
We agree that it's really complicated. Dr. Pieniazek, speaking from Poland, we did last year the case with Dr. Lee.
Yes.
So it's a very complicated case.
Have you performed a...
Before the case, we had a... Yeah.
Have you performed a brain perfusion?
We had a brief discussion. No, we don't have any data on the brain perfusion. But the patient does have left retina symptoms. So before the case, we had a brief discussion. We think that the target this time would be the left internal. And the protection device, I like to choose a filter wire because Mark is doing a MoMA case just now in the other room. And I've been doing MoMA for the last 2 years consecutively. So this time, I want to do a filter wire. But in fact, the real reason is that I'm afraid that the patient is not tolerant to any form of occlusion because the distal part of the ICA on the left side is maybe diseased. So I'm afraid that with the occlusion, the left cerebral perfusion will probably be impacted.
So that's an interesting interpretation of the MR, and I would agree with you. But I've always been impressed that patients will tolerate proximal protection in spite of multiple distal collateral incompetencies. I don't know why that is, but it happens anyway. I'm happy for it, but I'm not sure I can predict it as well as I thought I would. So I don't know if you have a take on that, Paul.
Bill, I agree with you, Bill. We can try MoMA, yes. If the patient is intolerant, we can still aspirate and fragmentize the procedure. But just for a good contrast of cases, so we'd like to use a filter on this one. Okay? So let's go through the angios we have done. The gentleman actually had a significant triple vessel disease. You can see the obtuse marginal, diagonal, mid-LAD are all diseased. And there is a very, next one, there's a very tight stenosis on the mid-right coronary artery. So I think after the carotid, Dr. Lee is going to treat the coronary
as
well.
Because he has an angina symptom.
Yeah, he does have a stable angina. Next one. Next. So this is the right common injection. You can see there's a segmental disease on the right internal, but not as severe as the that is shown on the MR. Mm-hmm. Next one. And this is the intracranial. We do find some narrowing at the proximal A1, terminal internal, and probably the proximal M1 portion. Next. But it's cross-filling the other side. And this is the right subclavian, tight stenosis, pinpoint. But the patient doesn't have any arm claudication, so probably we'll just leave it. This is the dominant left vertebra, healthy. Intracranially, it does provide some perfusion to the left MCA. Next one, of course, via the PCOM. And this is the left internal carotid. The patient swallows, so it's not that clear. Anyway, I'll show you a better one. This is the intracranial. You can see the ICA perfusion. Intracranial is very slow, and we cannot see A1.
It looked like there may have actually been some
cannulation.
There may have been some collaterals from the external that beat the internal filling.
Probably.
Right? Yes.
Probably. Yeah. And this is the cannulation. We are using an A French GR4 guiding. I'm a guiding guy, not a sheath guy. So for this one, I still use an A French GR4 guiding. And this is the actual roadmap shot for you. You can see it's a real string sign.
So, Paul, let's ask our panel, our vascular surgical panel group real quickly. I won't take much more time. But so string sign, right, that's not, classically we talk about whether or not a string sign should be approached with surgery or endovascular care. Here the patient's symptomatic, so it's less compelling a conversation. But if the patient were asymptomatic, what would you do with this case?
Yeah, I agree with you, Bill. Basically, for a symptomatic patient, I would choose surgery for this patient particularly. And, of course, the anatomy is better than we saw previous patient with a kinking, because the kinking particularly would be corrected with a surgery. You can do eversion, endotracheotomy, and shorten the artery. So, but by my mind, I would say this would be a good case if we would choose to treat both sides, the right side treat with endovascular technique and the left side with a surgery. That would be my choice.
Okay. Well, Paul, you've got one surgeon who's watching you very closely here.
I know, but my question to the surgeon would be, how do you handle the coronary? Do you do the bypass surgery before endarterectomy or concomitant?
That's a good question.
That's actually a very good question, and this probably is why endovascular technique for this patient.
Yeah, I mean, I think if we acknowledge that the surgery has more myocardial infarction, general, even without screening, and here's a patient with triple vessel symptomatic coronary disease, I think it's hard to make the argument that surgery is the first choice here.
And the pure contraindication for the surgeon in such a coronary field like this patient should be first treated with angioplasty and then maybe by surgeon performing carotid endarterectomy right now. There is purely contraindication for surgical treatment.
So, Paul, go ahead. We're not going to interrupt you, but we just want to have that little conversation.
So, I will just wire this lesion live because Dr. Lee prohibited me from doing a recorded live case.
So Dr. Lee worked with us for a while. He knows. Yeah, good to see you again, Dr. Lee.
Good to see you.
He knows all the tricks. I taught him all the tricks, Paul.
Yeah. I know. I asked him to be the operator. I want to assist him, but
that's the first trick. He's never be the primary operator.
This is a filter wire from Boston Scientific.
Give me a puff here.
So what's interesting here is a lot of people would think that because it's a filter and it's such a tight lesion that you won't be able to get this filter through. But I've been impressed that with most filters,
give me a
you can actually manage to transit this lesion with very atraumatic transition. It's not optimized. I appreciate that we would like to have a protection device in place before we touch this lesion. And for that reason, proximal protection is probably preferred. But I think you'll be surprised how quickly this will go through in most cases.
If I do this case with a filter device, I use a spider, make some predilatation, a small balloon for the delivery sheet for spider retriever, or a virion filter. There's a bulky device, this epi filter from Boston.
So
there's a too bulky device in such a lesion.
Okay. One of the, there, see how quickly this goes
see,
through.
You see, it's completely blocked. It's too much force.
May not go
I think
in an independent wire you can do small predilatation with a 1.5 balloon and then put a filter.
But you know what? Because for this particular case, I even want to try direct stenting. So I want to push the limit on the device. You see, I think the filter is being passed very slowly but steadily.
Yeah, that's it.
I think with any form of predilatation without a distal protection, I think we still run the risk of embolizing. So I think the filter is in a good position. I will deploy the filter now. Okay. Now the filter actually jumps in, but the loop is wide open now.
So there have been two very large retrospective assessments of predictors of outcomes in carotid stenting. And of those predictors of outcomes, age, symptomatic status, which is true for both carotid stenting and surgery, but also specific to carotid stenting, the use of a predilation balloon before filter placement is independently associated with worse outcomes on stroke. So we try to do what Paul's done here. Sometimes you don't have a choice and you have to do it, in which case we would do what Paul did. We would leave the filter there. We would leave the wire in place. We would take a separate wire, put that up next to that wire, always maintaining wire access to the lesion, predilate with a very low profile balloon, and then move the filter up. The other independent predictor, which
is exactly what we will do.
Yeah, the other independent predictor.
Yeah, sometimes.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. The wire portion had passed. So in my experience, with a very good supportive guiding position, I think with persistent pressure, I think the cone, nose cone will just make its way through. But if that's not the case, a body wire will somehow help to stabilize the system, and then you can still push on the filter. If that is not happening, then you can do a pre-predilatation, but I would use a very, very small balloon.
Right.
Because I don't like the notion of predilatating the lesion without any form of protection. And now that the filter is in a good position, I like to try, again, direct stenting with the carotid wall stent. Because I think the less perturbation before stenting to the plaque is better. Otherwise, we will probably have a full basket. I have to do this very slowly because there's a very tight fit between the stent and the guiding. So I don't want any air to be entrained. Okay, now it's very resistant. Huh? So I think I have to pre-dilate. But with the filter, I'm very confident.
3-0?
Why not take a 4-0 and get it done with?
Well, you know me. I like to have a good post-dilatation. So I have already chosen a 6 post-dial balloon.
So that's larger than most people use. Paul, tell me about your logic there. Why do you use such a large balloon?
Well, my routine is probably 6 because our stats showing that the Taiwanese, we have an average common carotid of around 8 millimeter, 7.8, and an internal around 5.8. So I think a 5-0 balloon would be a bit small. I know the stents are all self-expanding, so it will work its way through time. But I really want to have a nice result. I don't want the stent to be expanding when everything, any protection is already out of the vessel. So there could be a late cheese cutting, late distal embolization. So I want everything to be settled on table.
Do you mind putting a little bit of caudal angulation there? It might take the chin off of the lesion.
Yeah,
we're having a little bit of trouble seeing
caudal,
the lesion.
But yeah, if you
perfect, perfect, yeah. Beautiful. Okay. Thank you. Mm.
Okay. Give me a puff.
Small test. Okay.
Okay, let's go.
Carl?
Pressure 좀 스크린에 보여주세요. Blood pressure.
Six.
Yeah, this is Ikari speaking. Okay, Dr. Carl?
Ah, yeah, that's Ikari.
Hello. Yeah, your wire passage is fantastic. I'm so impressed. You have many experience about chronic total.
Six.
Which is your preferred wire for the chronic total for carotid artery?
Okay, well, it's almost like coronary CTO. So I will start with the hydrophilic wire. If the wire is not passing, I will use the hydrophilic wire to form a knuckle and then knuckle my way until the distal portion and then make a precise wire to re-entry, such as ultimate bro. So it's almost like a coronary CTO.
In calcified lesion, we can use also cutting balloon for predilatation in some people doing also. The cutting balloon is useful in a calcified lesion, it's so tight like this one.
In cases with a severe tight stenosis, 20 milliliter balloon is not desirable because when we use ballooning, it have a tendency to pulling back or jump out into the little. So in this case, I try to use 30 or 40 millimeter balloons.
Yeah, that is also a very reasonable idea. Okay, so I think with the 3-0, carotid wall stent should be able to pass.
Is it difficult?
Yeah, I think it will make its way. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's Where's your sheath or guide at this point?
In case of this, the flow is totally blocked, so the MoMA maybe could be also used in such a case because there's no flow with these devices, so patient tolerate quite well, so the MoMA could be an option in such a case also.
Yeah, I think you're right.
But with the filter, I think we have the liberty of taking everything out quickly. Not like the MoMA, you have to do aspiration first. Of course, you can use a MoMA and then pass with the filter wire and then leave the MoMA alone, or even take the MoMA, I mean the occlusion out. So it would be kind of a hybrid protection. But it's going to be very expensive.
So this really, I mean, this lesion is very, very organized fibrous, isn't
Fine.
It? And it speaks to the chronicity of the lesion. And probably the symptoms in this patient are more related to hypoperfusion than it is to embolic complication, which is an unusual source of symptoms in carotid disease. Probably less than 5 or 10% of the cases are related to hypoperfusion.
Yeah.
But we've seen his collateral circulation
is compromised. According to the patient's history, he doesn't have a sudden retinal embolic event, but it's a gradual diminished
right.
Visual acuity or visual clearance on the left eye. So it's probably a chronic retinal ischemia instead of a retinal infarct or embolus.
Right. I did a case like this once a long time ago, and the patient had a retinal edema. Actually, had a transient blindness over the next few days.
Okay.
Yeah, it's another form of hyperperfusion, right?
Exactly right.
Six, eight.
Four.
Oh, down the balloon slip.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So it's a very, very resistant lesion, huh?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Slowly, slowly. Four.
Slowly,
slowly.
Two.
Six.
The patient probably feels any pain, suffer from the pain, yeah.
No, he's not complaining. We do have some bradycardia, but I think the lesion is yielding. Slowly.
Slowly.
Six.
Two.
Eight.
Six.
Good.
There's some
down.
Asystole.
I think, okay, asystole for maybe 1 second, 2 seconds.
Yeah.
But he's coming back.
Sure.
Okay. I think responding to Dr. Lin's comment, I believe if we do a cerebral perfusion study before on this patient, it will show a ischemia on the left side hemisphere.
I think so with that A1 hypoplasia and vertebral missing and so on. Yeah, I think it's going to be a problem.
Let's do an injury. First of all, ask him if he's okay. And
오른손 좀 찍찍 해보세요. Right hand. 오른손.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, let's do an angio here. Good.
Great.
Great. I think great.
The basket, the filter is holding well. Let's do a subtraction intracranially.
So, Paul, I think the makers of rubber ducks must have noticed a spike in sales around 2004 or 5, not really understood why.
From our retrospective data using IBAS, we can detect plaque protrusion for 7 to 8%. So we can we think IBAS usage is mandatory for all the CAS cases. What do you think about
Well, what do you, I've seen that data, and I wonder, what do you do when you see plaque protrusion? Do you do something different for the patient? What is that good? What do you do when you see plaque protrusion?
I'm sorry.
Do you do a different procedure?
We perform additional ballooning or stent in stent.
Okay.
So, plaque protrusion is one of the main cause of late stroke after procedure.
Sorry,
well, I would say that that's probably true, but we don't really have data on that because we haven't looked at patients with or without plaque protrusion and which ones have strokes. So while I believe that that's probably one of the mechanisms, on true science basis, we don't have that data.
The best option is to use a little bigger balloon and use a lower pressure. If exists, still exists, so second stent could be an option. In mesh stent could be solution because in the new generation of stent, the plaque protrusion will be not a problem. We will use a mesh stent, C-guard or road saver.
I think that's right. Hopefully the mesh stents will help, yeah. Questions from our audience while we're waiting to wrap up this session. We have 7 minutes left. Paul, you've got plenty of time. We're going to go back to room one just for a moment when you're done for a final angiogram.
Sure. Sure. Are you happy with the final angio?
Spectacular.
Or you want to have an angio without the filter?
Yeah, really spectacular.
The carotid stenting is always controversial and very discussable procedure, so it was a very good case for demonstration, excellent case. That we can do all with distal protection, even when you have proximal protection. Excellent.
Okay, well, so I congratulations. Think that's our final result.
Congratulations.
Very satisfying, Paul.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Dr. Lee will work on the coronary now.
Yeah.
Good luck, Dr. Lee.
Okay,
thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Let's go back to room one just for a wrap up there for a final
I was
angiogram.
Just describing.
Yeah. What about the filter?
Okay,
let's have a look.
Can we go back to room one? Let me see. There we go. Okay.
Are you with me, Bill?
Yeah, go ahead, Mark.
Okay, so hopefully you've got the monitor image up there where we have both balloons down, guide wire still across, and the stent in place. Do you see that?
Yes, we do.
Okay, now if we can, basically after that we simply did cerebral imaging, so if we can go to the next image which shows the AP cranial subtracted, and on the initial angiograms the anterior cerebral really didn't show, the lesion was significantly stenotic, that we kind of had phasic flow in the A1 segment. You can see here that the anterior cerebral fills very well with no defects in the middle, and then we did a lateral angio as well, showing good filling in the cerebral circulation. And then we simply removed the guide wire and the MoMA device. The patient's done very well.
Terrific. Did you have any trouble getting that balloon out from an open cell stent?
No, actually it slid out very easily, no problems at all. There was no distortion of the stent as we drew it back.
That's a terrific case. Do we have any questions from our panel audience? Mark, both you and Paul did spectacular cases using different technology, open cell, closed cell stent, proximal protection filter. both did really expertly, and we appreciate all the effort and expertise. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much. Well,
thank you very much, and thanks to the Asan Hospital staff. Great job done.
Thanks again. Okay, that ends this session for our carotid live cases, and I'll turn this over to our next moderator. Thanks to our panelists for all their expert commentary. Thank you.